Less than 24 hours ago, as of the time of this writing, an indie video game developer named Nathalie Lawhead has posted a blog post on her own website where she accuses video game musical legend Jeremy Soule of raping her during her first job in the video game industry. However, she really should have hired an attorney to help her draft her accusations, because based on my previous experience as a paralegal, though admittedly in a different country than where this took place, her story seems like the sort of story that defense attorneys would get a boner over, because it is just too easy to poke holes at her story during cross-examination. First, her story is surprisingly devoid of details. Aside from the opening paragraphs, you have to scroll down in the blog post to be able to read anything pertaining to rape or even to sexual activity between the two in any capacity. Instead, she seems to be more intent on talking about the developmental nightmares that her first project went through and how they kept talking her into staying with the job she didn't want to stay with. And even if that could be considered unethical, although I would like to hear the manager's side of the story before I make a decision on that, it's still a far, far cry from rape. Okay, I'm about to do you guys a huge favor and sift through all the irrelevant bullshit and talk about the stuff police would be interested in hearing about if she were to ever go to them and file a complaint about rape. She met Jeremy Soule while working on that project in Canada. Side note, she refers to Vancouver as a country, which it's not, but that's a small little boo-boo in the grand scheme of things, and if she really were the victim here, I'd probably be overlooking such a small boo-boo. Anyway, she became friends with Soule because they were both artists, and they both love creativity for its own sake. Whoop-dee-doo! So Soule began complaining about how women have stabbed him in the back. So far, so good. Nothing inherently criminal or even unethical on Soule's part so far. Then she throws in how Soule starts indirectly, and even she calls it indirectly, threatening her job. The only thing she accuses him of at this stage is saying, "It's me or bust." Of course, she gives no context whatsoever behind that statement. So, even if Soule said that and she isn't just full of shit, we still have no way of knowing if it's actually a threat to her job, or if she's just overreacting to something that wasn't even directed at her, let alone meant in a threatening manner. Okay, that's all set up. Now, here's where we get to the actual rape. One night, she and him were hanging out and he started making advances towards her. She doesn't tell us exactly what he was doing, just that he was engaging in behavior that she, personally, would classify as making advances. Did he try and cop a feel? Did he start stroking her hair? Did he move in for a kiss? We don't know, because she doesn't tell us. So she says she wants to stay friends with him. Then she says he told her once again that it's me or bust. Bear in mind, we don't know how drunk either of them were, what sound was in the background, or anything. So we don't know if she misheard him, if she misunderstood him, or perhaps if he misheard her, or if he misunderstood her. For all we know, this could have just been one great big misunderstanding. But forget the petting. Forget the foreplay. Let's talk about the actual moment of rape, the big coup de grace, if you will. The part that should actually get Jeremy Soule locked up in prison, you know, the part where he shoved his penis in her vagina whether she liked it or not. That part. You want to tell us about that part, Miss Lawhead? Well, guess what? She doesn't. All she says happens to her after that was, and this is a direct quote from her on her own blog post, "He raped me." That's it. That's all she tells us about. This is literally the whole point of her blog post. This is what people are clicking on the links in order to read about, and she literally, literally just spends 3 goddamn words talking about it. I'm sorry, but if you honestly want to be seen as the victim here, instead of someone just begging for attention for her 15 minutes of fame, then we're going to need a little bit more to go on than just, "He raped me." That's a good headline. But we need more to go on once we start reading the article proper. Of course, the circumstances you describe in your blog post, assuming you can supplement these circumstances with details and, most importantly of all, actual objective evidence, don't even sound like rape to me. At best, it sounds like quid pro quo sexual harassment. Instead of holding you down, or threatening you with a weapon, or blackmail, or something else like that, Sol was, at best, dangling the carrot of career advancement over your head to entice you to give in to his sexual advances. Now, don't get me wrong, that is still despicable behavior, assuming you can keep your story straight whenever you are pegged for details and don't get to control what you do and don't say about the matter. I do not, by any stretch of the imagination, mean to underplay victims of sexual harassment in the workplace. That is indeed a very common and very serious problem. But to equate it with rape is nothing short of a bullshit false equivalence. I'm sorry, but your case against Jeremy Sol simply isn't rape. It's just not. Rape is one of the most heinous crimes you can possibly commit. You might have a perfectly valid case against Sol and your employer at the time if you were to call it what it actually is, sexual harassment. But by trying to overstate what it actually is, you are just making yourself look petty. Not that sexual harassment is petty, but it pales in comparison to the absolutely abominable crime of rape. I remember a few years back when a YouTube personality named Adam Blombier fell from grace after some woman had alleged sexual harassment over webcam against him. At first, he was devastated, thinking that he was a monster.
First of all, I just want to start this off by saying I am again so sorry for my actions and the hurt that they have caused, for the trust that I've abused.
But literally everybody else who was looking at the case from an objective standpoint could see clear as day that Adam Blombier did nothing wrong. To the contrary, it was the woman, not Blombier, who was taking advantage of the social stigma against men and in favor of women. The social stigma that presumes that women are the victims and men are the predators. It was clear to everyone else that she was just exploiting that stigma to get her 15 minutes of fame.
There is a huge difference in between what he has done and predatory behavior. Calm the fuck down. This is not what he has done.
That is mental. Seriously, absolutely mental.
Blombier eventually realized that he wasn't actually the monster he thought he was. That he was the one being taken advantage of rather than the girl.
Hello, everyone. Don't worry, this is not going to be another one of those Adam Blombier self-pity parties. God knows I hate those as much as you do. I still stick by kind of some of the things I said afterwards. Like, I know what I've done and what I haven't done. I know that I'm not a monster. I know I'm not a sexual predator.
I'm honestly getting deja vu here. This chick apparently is just vying for attention. Her only public statement regarding this alleged rape is so devoid of details and so riddled with plot holes that I honestly wonder if she just didn't pull it out of her ass. It's rather convenient that this supposedly happened in 2008. So long ago that any hope of any actual objective evidence to support these accusations, assuming there ever was any objective evidence to begin with, will have long since eroded away. Gee, isn't that convenient for you, Miss Lawhead? Before I close the video out, I want to make one thing perfectly clear to all of you. If this case were to go to court, Jeremy Sol would have the right to tell his side of the story, his attorney would have the right to cross-examine Lawhead to find flaws in her story. See, that's called the adversarial system, where the accused is allowed to present evidence in his favor just like the accusers are. Now, I want you to let this next part sink in because it's very important. That right exists for a reason. Literally anyone can make themselves look like the victim when they are the only ones who get to tell their side of the story. So I ask each and every one of you to keep these next four words in mind. That sentimentality exists in our legal system for a reason. If we start believing the entirely uncorroborated word of a single woman, with literally zero evidence to back up her claim, and who won't even give us any details about the alleged crime to begin with, then anyone can throw any accusations against anyone for anything! Nathalie Lawhead, either show us some proof, or shut the fuck up! So with that, I bid you all adieu. Ace Sir Thorin out. Peace!